And then a card is named. Let's say they go for the Eight of Diamonds. Okay, great. Deck down, everything is now just about the wallet. So you come over and you open it up. Once again, they can see there is just one card inside the wallet. They named the Eight of Diamonds. And when you take this card really, really cleanly, they can see that it is the Eight of Diamonds. How's it going, and welcome to this very special tutorial video. Why is it very special, you might ask? And the answer to that is, today I'm going to be teaching you a really powerful effect. If you know me, you know that I love tricks with a shuffled deck. But what's better than a trick with a shuffled deck? The answer is a trick with a named card. You show that there is just one playing card inside your wallet, and you invite the spectator to name any card that they like. And when you take it out, it is the very card that they named. There is absolutely no force either. It can be genuinely any card from a deck, and it works every time. Now, it is a little bit sleight heavy, but I'm going to teach you two versions. A simple version, which you can get started with pretty much right away. It really doesn't involve too much sleight of hand, but it's not as good. And then there is one that is absolutely killer, which is my favorite out of the two. It does involve a little bit more work, a little bit more sleight of hand, but it's gonna destroy your audience. There is also an advanced version of this trick that I will teach at the very end. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. Let's just start with the basic version of this. So here is what that would look like. So this is the basic version of the trick. We take a joker, which will be used in a second, and we take my wallet right here. What I'm going to do is place one card inside the wallet and seal it up. That is really, really fair. That's one card, and I am not going to touch that card for the rest of the trick. I'm going to use the joker to touch the card instead, so I'm going to be really, really fair about this and as clean as possible. They now name any card they like, and let's say they go for the Two of Diamonds, okay? Random card, the Two of Diamonds. We take the joker like this, and what I'm going to do actually is use the joker to open the wallet. So I said I wouldn't touch the card. I'm actually not gonna even touch the wallet, but we know what card they named, so this should be really, really fair. Let's see if I can poke this out. It might need turning over, actually. You can see that that's the Two of Diamonds right there. Okay, so that's the basic version of the trick. Now, immediately, some of you will be thinking that that's not very good. And fair enough, but what you do end up with is the card in the wallet. The reason I don't like this version is because of that joker. I don't like the justification of that joker. I tried to justify it as much as possible, but it's not my favorite, and I'm a little bit rusty on this version actually because I've not performed it in that long. The more advanced version of the trick looks like this. Same beginning with the card in the wallet. The deck can be shuffled or whatever, it really doesn't matter. And then a card is named. Let's say they go for the Eight of Diamonds. Okay, great. Deck down, everything is now just about the wallet. So you come over and you open it up. Once again, they can see there is just one card inside the wallet. They named the Eight of Diamonds, and when you take this card really, really cleanly, they can see that it is the Eight of Diamonds. That is about as clean as it gets when it comes to any named card inside a wallet. It really does look like that every single time. That was no force, I did just name any card. So there we go, that is card in wallet. Named card in wallet, not just signed card or anything like that. It is a card that they desire. and it ends up inside their wallet. Before I actually get into teaching the trick, the basic version followed by the advanced version, a couple of little pointers about this trick. It can use their wallet. That's a really important note. If you see someone who has a wallet that you think might work, what a trick to do. To know that this is an ungimmicked wallet is really, really powerful. Tricks that use your own wallet, well, it could be just a trick wallet that you bought from a magic shop. This doesn't need to be a trick wallet. I know that people are gonna have different sorts of wallets. When I teach this trick, you might struggle to make it work with your wallet at first. What I will say is this will work with any wallet. Just make sure that it's not too small. It needs to be bigger than a playing card. In this case, this wallet is pretty much the same size as a playing card with a little extra border around it. So it needs to be bigger than a playing card. Other than that, there are really no restrictions. So if you see a spectator with a wallet that might work for this trick, go ahead and use it. Even though you've not practiced with that exact type of wallet, you should be familiar enough with this trick by the end of it to be able to perform this with other wallets, not just your own. For now though, do practice with your own. And for the beginning, opening, basic version of the trick, you are going to need a joker that is identical to another joker. So you're gonna need two identical jokers. Let's get into the basic version, and that will really help you understand the advanced version, and then the advanced, advanced, extra advanced version, which we'll get onto at the end. Let's dive right in. In the basic version of the trick, you've got two identical jokers, and one of them is going to go in the wallet like so. So we close that up. That is where one of the jokers goes, and the other joker just goes to the side for now. So that's just off to the side. When the card is named, I would really suggest for this video that you watch my Any Card at Any Number, No Force Shuffle Deck Any Card at Any Number video, because I really think that that would help when learning this trick. Because there's a principle in that that I talk about that's not to do with sleight of hand or anything physical, it's just to do with your wordplay. And it's the idea that you have the card named, then you begin to talk, and in this case you introduce the idea of this card, and then you have the card named again once you've already controlled it, as if you've forgotten about the card, but the card is already controlled. So that is what I use when I do this trick. I have the card named, let's say it's the Eight of Spades, I cut the Eight of Spades to the top, I almost forget about it, and then I move on and I go, ah, right, before we begin the trick, I've actually got a card in my wallet right here. I am not going to touch this card throughout the rest of the trick. I'm going to close the wallet up, and we'll use the joker to handle the wallet and touch the card, just to make sure that I'm not, you know, hiding any cards or anything like that. This is really, really fair. So, what was the card again? So I've already controlled it at this point, but it's like the trick hasn't begun. As I said in that video, it's like a false start. I've already done the dirty work, and now I'm gonna get into the trick. So obviously they're gonna say Eight of Spades again. I already have the Eight of Spades controlled, I don't need to do any work. They think this is where the trick begins from, and so their memory of the trick is altered. They will go home thinking that you named the card and then straight away it was in the wallet. You didn't have to go to the deck or look through the deck or anything like that. Which is really sneaky, because you've already done that. Anyway, so, the Eight of Spades is on top of the deck, and you bring, at this point, you bring the Joker into play. And you take the Joker to the deck, and you load the Eight of Spades behind the Joker using a simple double lift. So you load the card behind the Joker, and at this point you're going to do that move that I explained in my last tutorial, which is a double turnover move. So they think this is a Joker, and it's actually the Eight of Spades. So I will go through that again. You have the Joker face up on top of the card, you've got your break, you turn both cards over, but in a way it's like the deck comes on top, and then with your thumb, you're just pushing that card forwards into this hand, and the deck goes to the side. And I think the further away the deck is from the wallet, the better. As if, like, the deck is now out of the picture, we don't need any cards. You now handle this card very fairly. Don't handle it as if you've got anything to hide. Don't, you know, be sort of like this. You just handle it like a normal thing, and you call this the Joker. So you say, what we'll do is we'll use the Joker to open the wallet. And you really do this. You just use the edge of that card. And you want this to look a little bit sort of like you've not practiced it. So don't sort of come in with a big flourish that's really well rehearsed. You want to struggle a little bit because you want it to seem difficult. You want to seem like, you know, I can't use any sleight of hand here, because I'm not going to switch the card. So you want that to be really difficult. So long as you don't turn this card over, you're okay. You probably see where this is going, so I'll cut to the chase. You now get underneath this card here, and you're going to do a switch. Now this principle, this idea, isn't mine. This has been used in a ton of tricks by a ton of different magicians. So this idea isn't mine, of using a card that is apparently a joker, a card that's actually a joker, and having the two switch in this way. That's an age-old principle. So you come over, and essentially the switch is this. You get underneath that card, like so, and then the idea is you're turning this over. But in order to have the cards the right way around, you come together, your thumb lands on this card, and you turn, you drop, and you pull back away. I don't really like this because you don't get the slow reveal of the card. And also the joker is a bit poorly justified in my opinion. It's a bit weird. Why do you need a joker? Why can't you just handle it with your hands like a normal person? It feels very magician-y. It feels like you're handling it like a magician, like a very weird sort of person. And although there is no sleight of hand, and maybe it's preferable for you in that case, I think a bit of sleight of hand to make a trick 10 times more powerful is a bit of sleight of hand worth learning. So let's learn it. In this version, a joker goes in the wallet. It is still a joker. Now, here's the interesting thing. It can be a joker. It really doesn't actually matter what this card is in this instance. What I would say is go for the Queen of Hearts. Now, the reason I'm saying go for the Queen of Hearts as the card in the wallet, even though it doesn't matter because you're ultimately going to switch this card out. In an ideal situation, what we want is, I've got a card here in my wallet. Name any card, they say the Queen of Hearts. They open it, they take the card and turn it over, and it's the Queen of Hearts. If you could do that every time, that would be a goddamn miracle. And the thing is, if 1 in 52 performances look like a miracle, then that's great. But if more than 1 in 52 performances look like a miracle, that's even better. Apologies about the dog. The reason I've chosen the Queen of Hearts is because the Queen of Hearts is the most commonly named card. If you say name a card to people, the Queen of Hearts comes up more than any card, and if you're a magician, you will know that. So why not have the Queen of Hearts in the wallet, and when the Queen of Hearts is inevitably named in some situations, you've got yourself a trick right there that is bulletproof. It's methodless, you know, because it is just chance, but they won't know that, and you can go away looking like the best magician in the world. So, there we go, free trick for you. You can just have the Queen of Hearts in your wallet at all times, and whenever a card is named and they say the Queen of Hearts, you've got yourself a trick straight away. That's a principle I write about in my magic book, and I call it the unused out, because it's an out that you don't always use, but when you do, it's killer. So there we go. Also, a little tip, I always keep a seven of hearts in my top pocket, just in case it's ever named. There we go, you can use that as well. That's another unused out. In this case though, they might not name the Queen of Hearts, and we need a trick to do if they don't. We need to have the card named first time and controlled. So they name, let's say they name the Five of Hearts, okay? If they name the Five of Hearts, what I'm doing to myself is I am scrolling through the deck until I hit the Five of Hearts, and I'm cutting it not to the top like I did in the other trick, but actually to the bottom. That's the only difference in this more advanced version with the control, is you control it to the bottom. The reason you control it to the bottom is eventually you're going to get this into a gambler's cop. We'll come to that in a second. So the card is controlled. I put the deck to one side just for the moment, and I say, look, we have a card in my wallet. And we do that whole thing talking about the card, and then we almost forget about the thing that we've already controlled. We ask them again what the card is, the false start for the trick. They say Five of Hearts, and we are set. And immediately, I am now ready for the trick. The deck goes down, and I'm ready. Because what I've done is I've got the card into a gambler's cop right here. This is called an adapted gambler's cop. I might do a whole video on the gambler's cop at some point because I think it's a really, really interesting move. But for now, this is just a way of hiding the card in your hand. That is essentially all you need to know. And the more relaxed you are and the more natural your hands appear, the better. And on camera, yeah, I might flash it, whatever. In real life, would they notice? No, of course they wouldn't, because my whole body language is completely ignoring this card. Not so much that it's obvious, but I'm just behaving like there's nothing in my hand. So, the card is already in Gambler's Cop. You can even ask them what the card is at this point, so the deck can be miles away. You're not even going to touch the deck. You can even ask them what the card is at this point. What is the card? And as they're saying it, you then get into position. And that is the position right there. So this little move I do, so we obviously have the card here. I pick the wallet up, the attention is on the wallet, the whole spotlight of the trick is on the wallet. And this is a great moment because I lean in, and leaning in subtly suggests to them, you need to pay attention to this, which is why they're not paying attention to this. So they pay attention here as I come like this and I pick it up. So what I did from behind, the wallet's on the table, I reach forward for the wallet and this comes here and I pinch that card behind. So that from the front, oh it slipped as I moved around, from the front they can't see it, and it won't slip, that is just because I'm rotating like some sort of spinning cactus. Down flat in the hand, I open the first layer, the second layer, I make sure the card doesn't fall out, and here's where things get really, really interesting. Because you're going to not do some sort of deal, you know, when I came up with this trick I was experimenting with almost doing like a bottom deal, but with the wallet as the deck, and the top and bottom card here, that doesn't work. It's just a very simple, you know, if you wanted to get this card out and you weren't a magician, what you'd do is you'd just do that, yeah? You would just pull it forwards. You wouldn't try and get it off the end here and do a weird thing like that. The easiest way is just that. So that is what we're gonna do, except we're going to load the card underneath the card. So you pull forwards and at this point your fingers are allowing this card to come forwards as well, and once they're both out, they are not squared up at the moment. The situation we have is this, so I will show you again. We've got the Five of Hearts, which is the named card, the Queen, which is one that they'll never see. You show, you come forwards, you pull like this, you allow the cards to come like so. What I'm not doing is doing this, I'm making sure the five is definitely on the side where my hand is, so that my hand is acting as a big shield. But I'm also not, you know, hiding it, obscuring it completely, and I'm not sort of coming out awkwardly like this. It's just natural. I'm only in this position for a minute. Once you get really, really good at this, you'll be able to align those cards with one hand, so that they don't appear to sort of, you know, the awkward thing of doing this. You really don't want that. What you want is just pull it out and turn it over. And so that is what you can do. So if you can align it with one hand, then great, go for that. However, I don't think there's anything wrong with, once you've pulled it out, just using both hands like this to hold them. So once you've done this and you've held it out, the trick is over. And if you want to clean up from this point, then you definitely can. You can come across, steal away the one underneath, and just be left with this card. You can, you know, hand that out, maybe not hand your wallet out, but you can hand the card out, and you are done. The only thing left to do now is clear up. So you've got your double, and you've got the deck. What you can do is just place that on top, do a little second deal, you've got the five, or you can do any sort of ditch you want. If you're putting these cards straight back in the box, and you've got your five, then you can just put that down there, put these in the box, and you've got your normal card. And all I did there was just drop the queen on top of the deck. So there we go. That is named card in wallet. A really, really powerful effect. A way of literally having them name a card, pull it out of your wallet. Simple as that. Now, yes, it does involve the deck. It involves the deck out and you have to cut to the card, you have to control it, whatever. So the advanced version would be no deck, surely. That would be the perfect way of making this trick better. Have no deck in play, just the wallet, have them name a card, open it up, and you're out. And of course, there is a way of doing that. And if you know about The Advocate, which is by Daniel Madison, if you know about The Advocate, what I will say is use it. I'm not gonna give any more advice. I'm not even gonna show you my advocate or anything like that. I can't do that. It's not mine to teach. What I will say is, if you know about that and you've got it in your pocket, then you can connect the dots. You simply, with one thumb, access that card, have it in Gambler's Cop, and the rest is as I've taught it. Load it under the wallet, perform the load of under the card, I don't even know what that move is called, square the cards up, show the card, you're done. But if you have the advocate, then yeah, you know what you can do to make this trick better. And if you don't, then using the deck is not bad at all, especially if you're doing other card tricks. If you're doing other card tricks that involve the rest of the deck, then instantly the deck is justified because you need a deck to do card tricks. And this trick, obviously, you're only really using one card. So yeah, I would say pair this with other tricks to justify having the deck. If you just come out with a deck and a wallet, do this trick and then go, well then obviously the deck is something to do with this trick. Whereas if you're doing other tricks that involve a full actual deck, then obviously the deck is just there because of that trick and not the wallet trick. You get what I'm saying? Okay, there we go. That is the tutorial for any named card in a wallet. Thanks for watching. Let's head to the outro. Thank you very much for watching this video, and I hope you enjoyed learning this trick. It's a really, really powerful one, so make sure to give it the practice and the respect that it needs in order to perform this correctly. I'm really happy that I shared this creation on YouTube, so I hope you enjoyed it, enjoyed learning this. Thank you for watching once again, and if you did enjoy this video, make sure to click the thumbs up button down below. That really helps me out. I don't really know why, but let's see if we can get 65.7 likes on this video. Is that how it works? If you enjoyed this tutorial and you want more like them, then I've made a lot of tutorials here on YouTube already, but also I'm going to be making a lot more every Tuesday. Well, not every Tuesday, but most Tuesdays I'm going to be posting a tutorial right here. And if I don't, that means I've forgotten. So I'm just being honest, I probably will forget at some point, but I'm going to try and make them every Tuesday. Tutorial Tuesday, sounds quite nice. See you in the next episode, and until then, take care.
I think you're gonna have to be. We're gonna have to go.